people to understand what makes us happy, what is really our passion, to understand it may take some time. But I actually love reading. I studies, and after that getting job, I was like became like workaholic. But after I started these activities to promote sports for the disabled, all these things, now I am able to understand actually this is my greatest passionate area.
It's truly fascinating how successful people approach problems where others see impenetrable barriers. They see challenges to embrace and obstacles to overcome. Their confidence in the face of hardship is driven by the ability to let go of the negativity that holds so many otherwise sensible people back. Without fail, people feel compelled to tell you what you should and you should not do because of your age. Don't listen to them. Successful people certainly don't. They follow their heart and allow their passion, not the body they are living in, to be their guide. Hello and welcome to the Honest Talk by Freak Folks. I'm Harsh Pandey. For this particular session, we have with us very special guest today, Ms. Madhvi Lata Prithi Gudupu, ma'am. She is an Associate Vice President in MNC Group, a former National Para Swimming Champion, the Founder General Secretary of the Paralympic Swimming Association of Tamil Nadu, and Founder President of the Wheelchair Basketball Federation of India. She founded the Yes We Too Can movement to encourage persons with disability to participate in youth. She is the author of her autobiography, Swimming Against the Tide. She is a TEDx speaker. She is a Toastmaster and worked as the president for the Toastmaster Club in her organization. She led the Indian Wheelchair Basketball Administration and coaches team who went to US on a sports visitor program. She was also the part of Rajiv Gandhi Khel Ratna and Arjuna Award Selection Committee in 2017. Her efforts and achievement have been covered widely by the print and electronic media. And ladies and gentlemen, let me tell you, her profile has so many things, so many glories, which I won't be able to share in the show notes. But I'm pretty sure during this conversation, we are going to learn a lot from her. So first of all, ma'am, I welcome you to in this session. Thank you so much for joining and agreeing to share your thoughts with us.
Thank you. Thank you. It's my pleasure, Harsh.
Thank you, ma'am. It's our pleasure too. So moving to the topic of today's session, which is obviously the name of your autobiography and the topic of this session, Swimming Against the Tide. I was going through your profile yesterday, ma'am, and found that you are a firm believer in the thought that there can be no barriers for your endeavor when you truly believe in yourself. And we have also seen that you have faced many problems, many challenges in your life. Still, you never give up, and the way you have actually handled it all is very appreciable and inspiring for all of us. Ma'am, my very first request to you is, please tell to our viewers, what is the source of your own motivation and how do you handle disappointment? Because today's youth, we have seen today's youth is very bad in this regard. They don't know how to handle disappointment or failure. So my very first request to you, please explain to our viewers.
Okay, sure. Actually, I also understood better after writing this book, how I manage different types of situations. Because at one shot, we are looking back our life and from childhood. When I wrote everything and after reading, I'm able to understand better. So what happened every time whenever I faced a problem, now if I see overview my life, it gave me some good opportunity. So every time it was like that only, and it gave me to understand my potential also. Because initially when my childhood, in teenage, when I wanted to go to junior college, there was no disabled friendly infrastructure facilities. So that's why when they were not ready to do any accommodations for me, I decided to appear privately. So that gave me, that gave me more confidence to learn anything on my own. And also I conducted tuitions at that time because generally I love meeting people. So I missed that opportunity because I was not able to go to college. when I started conducting tuitions in mathematics, just 1 year junior students to me. So that also gave me, that is another potential I could find in me and my teaching capacity. And also it helped, it gave me more confidence while studying. If we do something on our own and if we are able to earn something, it may be a small amount, but the confidence it gives, that is enormous. So that is why we are supporting in one way our parents. And what type of confidence it gives, I can't express in words. But later, when I was rejected to get a job, at the time my application was rejected because of my disability. Actually, my parents worried a lot, because from the beginning, from my childhood, they used to tell me, you should be on your own. You should not be a burden for anybody. So that's what they were telling me from my childhood. So they also lost hopes at one point of time. Oh my God, with this much severe disability, whether she would get job or not. But I was confident because of conducting tuitions, earning on my own something that, as a student. It gave me more confidence. Then I told them, let's try for some more. I will continue with my mathematics tutorial. So that confidence it gave to me. So like that, in each and every part of my life, when you see, that particular challenge gave me an opportunity. So that's why we should not look at challenges as a negative thing, and we should not get scared of that.
Indeed, ma'am. I think actually you have mentioned and told in a very beautiful way. And I'm sure the viewers who are watching this session, they are surely going to find this insightful. Now, my next question to you is, what we have seen is many people are still living someone else's vision of life instead of what they actually want to do. We have one life, and it's essential that we live each day in the best possible way based on what we desire, our ethics, passion, and the vision we have of living our lives. Now, my question to you is, please explain to our viewers, why is it important for one to realize his or ambiguous thoughts about life?
Ambiguous
thoughts about life.
Thoughts. Okay. Yeah, it may take some time for people to understand what makes us happy, what is really our passion. To understand, it may take some time. But what I observed in my case also, I actually love reading. I studies, and after that getting job, I was became like a workaholic. But after I started these activities to promote sports for the disabled, all these things, now I am able to understand actually this is my greatest passionate area. But after realizing that one, I never left that. But at the same time, I didn't leave my job. Once I love that job also. And apart from that, we need money for maintaining our day-to-day things, right? In one of the colleges, when I gave talk, one of the students asked me, Madam, if we passionate about something, suppose a photography or something, music, my parents are not allowing me to do that one, but how can I maintain both? So then I told that, okay, the situation is, it depends on individuals. Some people may get very good support and they may be able to go in that line from the beginning. But some people may not have that opportunity because of financial challenges.
Exactly.
But what I suggest is, we need to try both in such type of situation. But when we come to certain stage, then we can go fully into our passionate area. But what parents are telling also, it's not a bad thing, because we need to live ultimately.
Right.
If we go in our passionate area alone, we don't know initial stages whether it will give us money to take care of our needs. So that's why sometime the people like that in that stage need to manage both. So now I am also managing both my job and my passionate area. Both, working in an MNC in full-time job and doing these things, it's like my clock will be like maybe 5-6 hours I may take rest. It goes like that, but I am happy in doing those things. So that challenge will be there, but we have to manage.
Indeed, this is really actually a great thought. Ma'am, my next question to you is, how your life choices will always reflect your morals and beliefs, how they will aid you in making a deliberate choice on what is important to you. Please explain to our viewers.
Yeah, this value system also depends from mostly on the family, first of all, because how our parents are bringing up. Luckily, my parents tried to inculcate all good things, like, because they were like not teaching. They were following those things and try to tell. So over a period of time, all our children, their children, we all also lent those things, supporting others in case, whatever in the manner possible way for us. So we started continuing like that. Now, what I realize sometimes, you know, we see that people will criticize when we are doing something. But if we start getting scared about criticism, then we can't do anything. You might have heard one story that one donkey and father, son, they were going on the road. And initially, father told son to sit on the donkey. Then people started criticizing, what is this? How the son is sitting? Old guy, this guy is going. So then when they changed their seats, then people started telling that, you see that that guy is happily sitting, leaving the son like that. Then after that, both of them sat on the donkey. Then also people started criticizing.
Exactly, yes.
So like that, in that story, the essence of that story is, whatever we do, there may be people, some people may be there to criticize. So we should think about what is our goal, what is our values are telling, whether we are going in the right direction or not. If we believe that we are going in the right direction, we need not worry about that criticism. Only thing, if it is a constructive criticism, definitely we need to consider that whether any changes need to be made in our behavior. Other than that, we need to do things as per our values.
Indeed, ma'am. And my next question to you is, actually this is quite relevant as per our current society we are living in, and as per the current youth also, because we have seen society has molded us in such youth us in such a narrow one-dimensional way of thinking, because we were raised to believe that the only way to prosperity was to choose a career path and work our up that later. Don't you think we are always encouraged to chase money and job titles, but never pushed to evaluate and consider what we want our actual lifestyle to look like?
No, earning money is not a bad thing. But at the same time, whatever we discuss, you know, values, like Tata company, if you see, everybody, how they appreciate, because there is a big corporate, but still at the same time, when our country is in any challenging situation, country is facing, or if anybody is facing any challenge, how they are coming forward and supporting. So we can grow, and at the same time, we need to support others around us also to grow. So if we are able to do that one, nothing wrong in earning money or all these things. But only thing, I only should grow like this, all others go down, that is not correct. Or leaving all others to their fate and we only need to grow in our life, it's not a good thing. We should try all the, suppose if we are working in a corporate, all our team members also should grow along with us. It's not we only showing up to everyone that I am only doing everything. It is not the correct thing, right? So.
Indeed, ma'am. I think actually you have point a very great point that we need to think, and we need to actually concern about that we should grow together, not only should concern always about our individual growth. And my next question to you is, what we have seen, and actually it's a kind of a request to you, please explain to our viewers, everyone experiences imposter syndrome at one point or another. It's that pattern you find yourself in where you doubt your skills, talent or accomplishment, and it's persistent. You fear being exposed, feeling like folks will out you aren't as brilliant, amazing and fantastic as you they thought. My request to you is, please share some tips to deal with imposter syndrome. Also, it would be great if you could share some of your personal life experiences.
Yeah, with my personal experience only, I'll tell you. Earlier I thought that my life you can divide into two parts, before swimming, after swimming. So before I started swimming, I thought that I was like a topper in my school, and first class I completed, even though I appeared privately. So I thought that my brain is working well. So anything related to intelligence, brain, I can do. But anything related to my body, those type of things, I may not be able to do like others. like that one feeling was there for me, even though I was getting appreciations from everyone. But when I was able to enter into water because of my health condition, when doctor told my lifespan would be 1 year in 2007, when he told that success chances were also minimal, then I opted for hydrotherapy and physiotherapy. As a part of that, I entered and later I became a national champion. So really that changed my thought process a lot. Suddenly I realized it's like an what is the Eureka moment in my life. Suddenly I realized that, I can, swimming, you know, many people get scared to enter into water, non-disabled also. So with my severe disability, I was able to enter into water at that time and I could swim, became champion at the age of 40 years. So then it changed my perspective towards life. Then I realized that, this physical abilities that don't matter. If I want to do anything, I can do. Maybe I may not be able to swim the way you swim. I may swim in a different way. The time also may be lesser than you, but I can swim. I can do. So that changed my thought process a lot. Now I know that everything is possible for me if I want to do. That is a class objective. If I don't want, mobile from here to there also, I may not do that. So if I want, I can do. So that's what we can learn either from our experiences or others' experiences. After seeing others also, we can understand it's possible. So definitely, I hope you can also agree with me.
Yes.
That I am swimming means it's really, I feel very happy even today.
Indeed, ma'am. This was really very inspiring answer from you, right? And ma'am, my next question to you is, actually you have founded the movement called Yes We Too Can to encourage people with disabilities to participate in its in sports. So ma'am, my first question to you is actually, what do you think, what are the kind of difficulties people face, actually the person with disabilities face in public places, and what are the things still needed to do in this regard?
There are so many challenges because only one thing, most important thing required right now is awareness creation. Sure. So the more people knows about the challenges, when I gave a talk at one place to very senior officials in government, I told about my challenges in using a toilet, because many places, wherever we go, sometimes inside the toilet it may be spacious, but entrance they will keep narrow. How can I go enter into that with my wheelchair? So I explained very clearly how I face throughout my life. That is the biggest challenge for me, because we can't avoid that. And at the time, the facilities are not fully accessible. So I explained after 1 year when I met him also, that official, madam, on that day when you told it, it's in our mind that generally we may not think about in that angle when we invite a person with a disability, whether they are able to use the toilet or not. Every time people may not think, right? So the more awareness is created, then people will start thinking. I will tell that, like, suppose if there are only one avenue to keep, one toilet only option is there, place is available, let us make it an inclusive toilet. So everybody can use. Sometimes, you know, people will tell that, we have very little place. That is why we made like this. We don't have place to keep another accessible toilet. Why we need? So that's why the construction itself, if we think about those things, if we make the place inclusive for everyone, accessible for everyone, everyone can use. It's not about disabled or non-disabled. So that is the biggest challenge, accessibility. Transportation related, and most important thing is attitude, because people should not think that if this person is disabled, so the person can't do it, this one, that one, not. We need to start thinking why this person is not able to do, whether my organization is not upgraded, developed to that stage to include everyone. That is the point should come to everyone's mind. Then this world will become a very welcoming place for everyone.
Indeed, ma'am. Actually, this is a very positive change, and we need to actually look into this regard. And ma'am, one question which I asked, actually, I have discussed with one of my previous guests, and also I have heard many times that normal people actually they try to help even the people with disability don't want. So, ma'am, in this regard, do you think that people actually come and help you if they think like that? You certainly need this kind of help, even if you don't want. So how do you look this?
Yeah, this one I want to tell for persons with disabilities. I want to tell them, if you need support, don't hesitate to ask.
Yes.
If you don't need support, don't hesitate to tell them. Suppose if I am able to push my wheelchair, and if you come and ask, Madam, do you want my help to push your wheelchair? I can tell politely, no thanks, Harsh, I can manage. So if I tell like that, then it will be comfortable for you. And if for non-disabled people, I know this type of question many times I face. So I want to tell you people, if you want, because sometimes, you know, the persons may not be that much confident to tell you that I don't need support or I need support.
Yes.
So if you are able to understand from the situation that person needs some support, you can politely ask them, do you want me to do this one? Do you want me to give this back to you? Like that, if you ask, then that person will tell whether it is required or not.
Mm-hmm.
So always I will tell people, have open conversation, whether it is in interviews or anywhere. That is the best thing. When people ask me, Madhvi, I'm going to recruit some person with certain type of disability, what I should do, like that, I told that I am not the person to tell you. You ask that person. Because all the wheelchair users also may not have same requirement.
Yes.
It may vary from person to person. So it is always better to have open conversation that will make life comfortable for both disabled and non-disabled people.
Indeed, ma'am. Actually, you have said this is really a great point you discuss, and I really want to discuss this from you. Thank you so much for sharing this, and I must say there's a lot more to learn from you, and the kind of energy you brought into this session was very inspiring for me as well. I don't want to take too much of your time, so moving to my last question of this session, or rather it's a kind of just I'm seeking advice. What will be one piece of advice would you like to give to all the young millennials?
I don't like to give advices generally because when we observe others, how they are working, functioning, if we are able to understand better, that will have more value. Simply somebody is coming giving advices. But only thing is, be like yourself. That is important. Always we should be like ourselves, then we feel happy. That is important. We should not try to behave like some X, Y, Z like that. That won't give you happiness.
Indeed. Actually, you have again mentioned a very great point that made a great point, that be yourself. Thank you so much, ma'am, for sharing in this, actually coming in this interview and sharing all your experiences. It was a kind of a healthy discussion with you on the topic. We look forward to end up more such session with you in future.
Thank you. Thank you. Sure. Thank you, Ash.
Thank you, ma'am. I truly enjoyed this. Thank you.
On the ground is where I stand. Never give up. That was always the plan.
It's so cold outside. I'm alone.